Hello, I'm David Burton with University of Missouri Extension, and welcome to what I believe is episode 59 of Neighboring 101, which is part of the Engage Neighbor program at the University of Missouri. And this is the fourth in five special sessions focused on the faith in the Ozarks, the faith of your neighbors. And we've had panel discussions with pastors from various faiths to help explain what different denominations, different types of faith believe. It's an educational thing that we're doing, and I think you'll find this panel very interesting. It was a great discussion, and we want to bring that to you. It's about an hour and 20 minutes long, a good conversation, and sharing is not as easy as it once was on this. So, but without any further ado or any more conversation from me, if we can get the sound right, I want to bring you that panel discussion. This took place at Missouri State University in the theater there at the Plaster Student Union, and it will take you straight to that discussion.
Everyone for coming, those that made it out here and figured parking through the homecoming that's happening. Thank you for making it out. I'm Deanna Carpenter. I'm with the Half Faith Initiative with Community Partnerships of the Ozarks. We have Dr. Stephen Berkwitz on the end down there, who is with MSU's Department of Languages, Cultures, and Religions as well. We will be co-moderating this. And who we have here is Orin Cummings, Pastor Orin Cummings from Messiah Lutheran, Pastor Jeremy Muniz from Ridgecrest Baptist. We have Pastor Stephanie Scott-Huffman from Church of Christ. Did I get that right? Did I get that right, Stephanie?
United Church of Christ.
I knew I was missing a word. And then we have Mark Cohen with Temple Israel, which is our Jewish temple in town, if you didn't know that. And then we have Steve Watt, who is with our Pagan Temple community here locally. So that is who's on our discussions tonight. We have some questions, and how it will work if you've not been here, we'll ask them a series of questions. And then at the very end, you can ask whatever questions you're interested in asking, and then we'll do a luncheon meal afterwards up at the top. So I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Stephen Berkwitz.
Instead, we're here to share and to learn. So I'd like to just reinforce that message. We have not had any issues up till now, so I don't think we'll have any issues now either. The other thing is I'll ask our panelists, when we have a big panel with a lot of material, I'll ask our panelists to try to keep their responses to about 2 minutes, if possible, so we have time for everyone to talk and to take any questions from the audience after. So I guess I'll begin. I have the first question. And this question here is,
close to. Our congregation meets on Seminole, a couple of blocks west of Mercy Hospital. And Messiah Lutheran is one of the congregations of the Evangelical Lutheran Church of America, one of the largest of the Lutheran churches. It's been there for many years. And there was an opportunity in the past for us to move to somewhere else. But the congregation decided to stay where it is, to be a church in the community for the community. So in terms of what we do there, apart from worshiping, we have a safe to sleep house in which we have three families from that are appointed to us from council churches, help those families re-enter into society. We keep them for a year, help them with financing, and then launch them. We have two houses in which we have two Ukrainian families that have come because of the war. We help them to integrate into the culture and be established in the community. And then apart from that, we collaborate with the Holland Neighborhood School and the Neighborhood Association. And then there are other things that we do in the community. And, you know, as we go along, I can share that, but I think my time should be up.
My name is Jeremy Muniz. I'm the senior pastor at Ridgecrest Baptist Church, and we're on Republic Road on the south side of Springfield, just outside of the city limits, just right on the very edge of town. And the church is it's about 40 years old. It's not been there for a very long time, but it's a church that has, over the years, had a missional heart, and we have ministries here in the community and around the world. We support other Southern Baptist churches. There are 1,800 Missouri Baptist churches in the state of Missouri, and we cooperate and fellowship with them. And then in our community, we're always looking for opportunities to care for people wherever the needs may be. And I can't wait to talk to my brother. We actually have a Ukrainian refugee in our home. So we have been very heavily invested in the Ukrainian situation and have worked hard to help those individuals who have been displaced by war there. So we look for opportunities anywhere we can and try to be a good neighbor and a good friend to those in need.
My name is Stephanie Scott-Huffman, and I'm the pastor for St. John's Chapel, United Church of Christ. We are on Fremont in Republic, and we've been there for roughly 53, 54 years. We're a Protestant, mainline Protestant church. We're an open and affirming congregation, which means we've gone through a process and a process of discernment, of training, of understanding, and prayer to be a safe space for gay, lesbian, transgender, bisexual folks to come and join the community, whether that looks like worshiping or joining in some outreach efforts or just a place for folks to connect. We believe that that we're trying to be the heart of God through love, and and not just by words, but also by action, which I think is what a lot of us are trying to do in the community. We've been involved in crisis cold weather shelter. We've done aimless work in helping other folks get on their feet, back into sustainable housing. And we look forward to doing a lot more. I've been there for roughly 3 years, and I'm excited for our future and what's going to happen next.
I'm Laura Cohen, and I'm here to represent Temple Israel. We currently have a part-time rabbi who is not here right now, and we'll talk about that later because it's the holiday season for us. The congregation has been around since 1893. Although not in its current location, we've been all over. Right now we have about 70 households, give or take. Our big community support is the community garden, which donates tons and tons and tons of food to Ozarks Food Harvest. And we have lots of help from various church communities to help us with our amazing garden.
My name is Dave Walsh, and I'm an elder with Down-to-Earth Pagan Community Temple. We're close. We're just going to be there. But I didn't want to say an elder just basically means I've been around for a while. You may hear people say a high priest or a high priestess. That's pretty much just the people hosting the ritual, because in our faith, we all believe we're our own priests and priestesses, and we have our own personal relationships with gods. For instance, I'm a simple head witch. My goddess is Mother Earth. My god is Father God. But then you have a lot of other folks out there that follow all the different mythological pantheons. And some don't follow anything at all. They're just living in harmony with nature. We are fairly new to this area. We just formed back in May. So we don't have a lot of the stuff that all these other folks are doing, but we've got a lot of big plans. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. I think it's wonderful to hear how long some of these faith groups have been in our area and how some are new and some have really old grassroots here. But I think it gives us a foundation of understanding as we add on to that. So let's do that. Let's dive into some principles that really inspire and guide your faith. I'm sure that you could probably do a day-long sermon on what that meant in your faith, and so it might be a little hard to condense it. But when you think about what are those guiding principles that your faith in particularly focuses on, and we are going to jump actually to Reverend Stephanie first, and then we'll go to Reverend Jeremy and Reverend Orin, and then we'll come back this way just to mix it up.
So to know me is to know that if I don't take some notes ahead of time, I might take us down several rabbit holes. So I have to pause and look at some notes that I jotted. In thinking about this and discerning it and holding it in prayer, I really think that one of our biggest principles that inspire and guide my faith and also some other people's faith that I'm in relationship with is love. That, for me, being the root of all things, the lens of all things that I use in my own life. And that really calls me to a strong, if that's the place I'm starting, then what does that mean? How am I treating my neighbors? How am I judging my neighbors? How am I supporting my neighbors? How am I creating safe spaces for people to share the things that they're going through? So, and the good news in that is that Jesus is in that. And not just Jesus. And I think that's pretty great, because I really think God or the divine or the holy or whatever words we use is in all of that.
So yeah, the principles that inspire and guide our faith, we would say that we have Baptists have a Protestant background, an evangelical background. Some of the classic statements of faith over the years we would hold to, back to the Apostles' Creed, and so talking specifically about things like that, we have a Baptist faith and message that builds on other Baptist creeds, and so those are our basics. But to talk about what we are about, we take the Great Commission of Jesus seriously, and we try to apply that in everything that we do. And I would agree, love, loving people well, and sharing Christ, sharing Jesus is central to who we are and what we do. So, but when there's two questions here, and I'll elaborate a little bit more on the next one. But as far as that goes, the principles I would say that guide us are those statements of faith and those things that anchor us. And then from there, as a church, we have our values, and we call them our treasure principles. And those are the things, we have seven treasure principles, and I won't get into those, but that's how we see that as how we express those creeds and those statements of faith that can be a little bit dry. We want to apply those in community, and so that's how we see our values working out in community and in ministry.
So I would say that what they have said is not unlike where we are. But I want to begin by saying that the principle by which we are guided as a church is justification by grace through faith. And that is the core of who we are. By saying that, I mean, there's a lot of words, but the essence is the grace of God. For without the grace of God, we are nowhere. And it is on the basis of that grace that we then live as people of grace, expressing love, both for God and for the neighbor. Now, I must say personally that when I come to the faith, I'm shaped by that song that you know very well, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. I believe all of us are shaped by that song. I want to make a corrective to the song, because I believe that Jesus loves me, this I know, for my grandmother told me so, or my pastor told me so. In other words, it's the relationships through which we come to Jesus Christ. Not the Bible itself, but the Bible validates those relationships. And so it's on the principle of relationship, that love for the neighbor, that love for God and is expressed in the love for the neighbor, that guides and inspires what we do at Messiah, or how I live my life out, because I'm a product of missionaries. I mean, I'm not from America, North America. I'm from South America, but more specifically the Caribbean. And it was missionaries who came to our church, came to our community and established churches and built the faith. So it's those relationships that I think are important, that are established in that justifying work of Christ that we all, I believe, here around this table would willingly and wholeheartedly acknowledge.
We tend to live in harmony with nature, but we are modern people. I wrote here today. Yeah. We do have several rules that a lot of us follow. We are a fairly diverse group. But one of the rules we follow is, and it's hard one to battle with, that one is, sometimes when you talk to me, we'll spend a night going over those eight little words. Another one we believe in is the threefold law. What we put out comes back to us threefold. So if we put out joy, we get back joy. If we put out negativity, back negativity. And the other one, as most of y'all said down there, love is the whole of the law.
Interesting, because this has been a lot of reflection in the community right now, these questions. One principle is that we strive to be as much like God as we can be, understanding that we cannot be God, right? So we can, it's the math person in me, we can be asymptotally near it, but never quite reach it. I'm striving on that. It's hard some days. And the other is the concept of tikkun olam, which is the idea of saving the earth or caring for the earth. Jews believe that God did not finish the creation. And so it is our job to finish the creation and care for the earth, because it's not ours, it's just ours on loan. It's God's. loves me? Yeah, no, not that one. Not part of my culture.
I wanted to sing it for you, but I didn't. I just assumed that you knew it.
Yeah, no,
we
right.
Can sing it after.
Okay. This. Gotcha.
All right. So this is a really interesting discussion so far. This next question is kind of similar to the second. I'll read it and then I'll try to give some gloss for it. So the question reads, what would you say are the most important religious virtues in your faith? In order to distinguish this from the second question, maybe I'll add, what kinds of persons, individuals, does your faith strive to form? What kinds of characteristics do you think people might develop as a result of being part of your community? And should we start? Yeah, let's see. Yeah, we'll mix it up again.
All right, well, if I understand your question correctly, the thing that we try to get most of our people to come to is kindness and gentleness. We want to live in harmony with the earth. That's all of the earth. That's the people, too. We want to build bridges among other people. We do want to let people know that we're not things that they've heard. And we are looking for character that comes from within. And honesty is a big part of that.
I want to say good people, but I think that's an awfully broad, vague concept. That's the English professor in me. And I want to say righteous people, but I don't mean that in a saintly way or a frightening way. So I want to say caring people, civically minded people, people who do the good, who do the right, who are just.
These are good answers.
You can just help me, Mom.
It's well, I'm kind of sensing a pattern here. I go back to that root of love, and for me it's like an image of a tree, and out of that love is that grace and compassion and empathy, but also responsibility to each other, to our neighbors, to the earth, to all of creation. I think out of that, looking through that lens and trying to, when I talk about love, I'm definitely not talking about the feel-good kind of love with rainbows and unicorns and sweet tarts. I'm talking about the hard love, the love that we oh, they're Baptist, or, you know, they're pagan. No, pushing through that and really calling us to come together and unite. I come from a faith tradition, the UCC, formed in 1957, and it was five denominational background streams. It was evangelical, it was the Christian church, it was, I'm getting so excited, I'm forgetting them all now. I'll come back to it. But just to think that these five denominations came together, and they were so dedicated to this idea of unity, that they push through the little things, they push through the hard things, the things that divide us in our religions, in our faith traditions, in our beliefs, the things that, look at what's happening in our country, right? There's a whole lot of division, and it's because, well, it's obviously because of many reasons, but they pushed through all of those things, and they were focused on that unity, and they were going to make that happen, and they did. And I don't know the last time I saw five churches come together from different backgrounds to make that happen. And so I say all that to say, when we focus on those things like love, and even if it's your starting point is grace, there's so much that comes out of that. If they're
So as I was thinking about what to share here, I am a Baptist, and I want to talk a little bit. I think the answer to this question, the important religious virtues in our faith, Baptists in America came here because of persecution. They weren't able to have church the way they wanted to, and so Roger Smith was a Baptist for just a little while, and he was in Massachusetts and got kicked out. We Baptists were pretty good at that in the colonial period. Got kicked out a lot. And so they went to this place called Rhode Island. And the idea was they wanted to have a place where the conscience of the individual was respected, where people could think for themselves. Now, I would imagine that everybody on this panel, we are who we are, and we believe what we believe. And we would not agree on things. And the Baptist ideal in the early days, and sadly I think my tribe has gotten away from this to a certain extent because we tend to be more divisive and not looking for the other, listening to the other. But in the early days, a very important principle was that freedom of conscience. And so what that did in America, there were Baptist preachers who were standing up for this, and there were state churches. And as far as I know, I don't know of any Baptists that were killed in America, but they were certainly beat up from time to time in Massachusetts and in Virginia. And so they got together, and they wanted to have a place where everybody could have their viewpoint, that they could sit around a table and share that. And so basically, that's what inspired Thomas Jefferson and some of the early founding fathers of this country to have a separation of church and state, which I think is one of the most misunderstood ideas even today. But the idea was not to protect the state, but to protect the church and the conscience of the individual. There shouldn't be someone telling someone else, you have to be this or you have to be that. There are ideas, there are different ideas. I believe some ideas are better than others. And so, but I also believe that every one of those ideas ought to be discussed in a rational and careful way. And so Baptists had two basic principles. One was very theological, and that was the respect for the freedom of conscience. Another thing was political democracy. The belief that everybody should have a franchise and have a vote, which is more of an Enlightenment idea. But that's when Baptists came to America. That was really the core. And I just think that's what makes America so great, is we can have a meeting like this and we can have conversation like this, because there should be that openness where we come and we throw those ideas out and we listen to them together, and we go with the direction where in our minds and our hearts we feel like the truth lies. So that to me is a key part of our background.
Very important question that we should consider. I'm going to address the question from our mission statement. Our mission statement says, guided by the gospel, we welcome all to worship. That says, there's no one locked out or excluded from the community. So the principle is a principle of inclusivity rather than being guarded or excluded of others. We build on that by saying that we will make disciples. Hence, the emphasis is on the call to share the faith. Not to impose it on anyone, but to share it. That to share it in a way where it makes sense to us that the other hear our story and enter our story, okay? Then we talk about nurturing youth, because in the Lutheran tradition, we practice infant baptism as a core value of who we are. We do so very intentionally because we feel that the church is a church for all people, and hence by practicing infant baptism, we emphasize again there the justification by grace, that it is God's work that brings us into this faith community, not we of ourselves bringing ourselves into the faith community. And so nurturing youth is that when we baptize infants, we have as a covenantal responsibility to bring them up in faith. So it's not that we leave them alone, you know, to fend for themselves, to find their way. No, we nurture, we care for them as a community alongside their parents, alongside their spouses, right? And that we hunger for ministry, hence the effort to be in the community for the community and not for ourselves. We're not a church for ourselves, but we're all a church for us. And therefore, we gather resources for growing ministries because as we are in the community, we will grow the faith, not to make Lutherans of others, but to encourage people to have a relationship with Christ. And then finally, offer healing and care to all in need. Now, in that statement, the principle of our faith as we live out in the community, we find it important to start with a place of worship because there is where we gather, we hear the word, we feast at God's table the meal, and we're sent into the world. So what we do in worship is not for ourselves only, but it shapes how we live in the community. It has an impact on how we present ourselves in the community, how we engage and interact with others in the community. So I would say those are the virtues by which we are guided.
That's wonderful. I don't know if you're enjoying it as much as I am, but I was taking notes, and I kept thinking, as you were all sharing, some of the common threads. I don't know if you're feeling them and seeing them, but wanting to have compassion and stewardship and responsibility, and it's not about receiving something, but about becoming and changing and being. And I'm hearing this thread throughout, and I love how even Pastor Jeremy talked about the conscience of the individual to be respected. And I hear that with everybody in a different way, and the responsibility of caring and nurturing kind of blended to that. So I appreciate you and sharing, and I do think we have a lot of commonality as we get down to those basic tenets of how we are becoming and what we want to become. So this is a question that's a little bit different angle. It might be more spiritual, it could be more fun, depending upon what angle you look at it. But I'm really interested in a holy day, a special day within your faith, whether that's one or two, or what angle you want to take it. But what does that look like? I'm not there. I haven't shared with you in it. Shape it for me. What does it mean to you? What does it look like? Help me envision it. And Pastor Orin Cummings, I'm going to jump to you first, and then we'll come back.
Well, there are many holy days that I think most of us here around the table will identify, such as Christmas and Easter and such like. I want to go in a different direction. I want to go with a day that really is definitive of who we are, and that would be Reformation. I remember serving in Kansas City as a Lutheran pastor, helping out the Episcopalians, and I was with the Episcopalian Church for 5 years. And the first year I said, well, we will celebrate Reformation Sunday, and they all said, well, we don't know what that is. And I said, it's an opportunity for us to grow in faith, therefore. So we're going to do a little bit of teaching about it. Now, we always celebrate Reformation at the end of October. So when the fuss is on Halloween, for us the focus is on the 31st of October, 1517, when Luther established the Reformation, right? Luther and the Reformers. So for us, that's a very important day. It's a day when we reflect seriously on who we are as a people of God, and how it is that we are who we are, not to the exclusion of others. And I like to remind my congregation ever so often that you know, sometimes we talk and we sometimes speak in a disparaging way about others, for example, Roman Catholics, because Luther came out with Roman Catholicism. I like to tell people that Luther did not want to establish the Lutheran Church. Luther wanted to reform the Roman Catholic Church, the church in which he was and served as a priest. And to exactly that was the intention with the Oxford Confession, which is an ecumenical document. We sometimes forget that. It so happened that it splintered the church. But at the very core, at the very core of who we are, I like to bring them back to the fact that, listen, as Lutherans, the Roman Catholics is where we came from. That's our roots. That's how to where we come. So we don't speak disparagingly of them or of others. So for me, the Reformation is important as a festive day. It helps me to reclaim that theme of justification by grace through faith and to sing with gusto, a mighty fortress is our God.
Well, my daughter's birthday is October 30th, so that should be my favorite holiday as well. She's a Reformation baby. I thought that what I would stress is Baptists don't have as much of the high church tradition, it's a more free church tradition. So a lot of the different observances that you might get in a Lutheran church and other churches, we're not as good at that. But really, I think for Baptists, historically, Easter has been the focus, and that's our day. It's a big day with a big crowd. But for me personally, when I was a young boy and my grandmother passed away and I was first confronted with death, I began to ask the question, with a central question, not what happens when you die, but the real question is what happens when I die? We can always, even with the question, if we say you, we're always talking about the other, but I feel like that the question has to be asked very personally. And Easter has the answer for that for me, and that is that Jesus died and rose again. And that is the hope I have. It challenges me to think about life in this world. It doesn't give me a high-in-the-sky worldview. It makes me think more deeply about living life well. But it also gives me hope, especially in those moments when I'm with families and they're walking through the valley of the shadow of death. It's an anchor for my heart. So Easter, I think in the Baptist tradition, we do Christmas pretty big too. But Easter really is a focal point of our ministry and probably the holiday that we focus on the most.
So the one nice thing, or the one neat thing about the United Church of Christ is that people observe different holidays, and where you might find one church is celebrating a holiday called Maundy Thursday, not everybody is. Maundy Thursday is the Thursday before Good Friday. And if you ever join us, even if you're not in this faith tradition, you'll walk in the door and you'll smell soup. And you're welcome to sit at a table with people and break bread. And it's the one time a year I get really excited to make two big pots of soup and have a simple supper of the soup and this bread and water. And we intentionally share a meal together, and we reflect on that last night that Jesus lived. And we reflect on his life, and we're not doing it as an act of worship or just something to do, but really embodying it and bringing it into ourselves and reflecting of how do I, what does this mean for somebody to die in this way, no matter what our beliefs are about Jesus or who Jesus is, but to really think about all the things that, what does it take for somebody to never to deny their faith or never deny the teachings and all of that, and questioning what we're following and what we believe and getting back to our roots and really just taking time to explore and reflect and reevaluate our values. And it's so far from right here with some of people's favorite time, and I think it's because of the relational piece with
I want to talk about Yom Kippur, which just passed, which some of you know is the Day of Atonement, which is considered the holiest day on the Jewish calendar. It's a 25-hour fast for those who can fast. I can't fast, so I fast between meals. And it's a day that, as a kid, I did not appreciate, but as an adult, I really, really do, because it's a day of introspection and reflection. It goes back to that idea of striving to be better than we are. And it ends a 10-day period of reflection and apology making. So we cannot enter Yom Kippur and apologize to God for things that we may have done to that offended God before going to our fellow persons and asking forgiveness for things we may have done that may have offended or disturbed them in some way. And so while there's a lot of ritual that is involved in that, and a lot of time in communal prayer, which is lovely, very meditative, I find it very soothing, and the companionship is good and all of that, it closes with the blowing of the shofar, of the ram's horn, which is the traditional horn used, you read about it in the Hebrew Bible, the call for holidays, the call for prayer, the call to arms, right? So you get that historical context, right? We're over 2,000 years. We use this same darn horn. And tradition has it that when the person who blows it, or people who blow it, depending upon the community, is called up to blow the final blow of a 10-day period, the longer that noise can be held, the greater joy will happen during the course of the year. So everybody kind of takes a deep breath with the person who's going to blow it. And they start, and there's a particular way they have to make the sound, and they start with that sound, and then they keep going, and their face turns red, and everybody's holding their breath with them, because gosh, we're going to make it. And you never applaud in Jewish service. You don't. That's minor, it might be called rude, but that's a very kind word for it. But when they're finished, there's this explosion of joy. And everybody's applauding and calling out good words, well done, that kind of thing. And it's that kind of moment, one, because we're all there together and we've all kind of ritually blown that horn. We're all also really excited because back in the social hall, dinner is there with soup. And we've all done this together. And it's that moment and that beginning of the new year and that communality. It's just, I love that day. I don't know that anybody else would say that about a fast day. But that moment is so significant. And knowing that every Jewish congregation around the world has that same exact moment and that same exact feeling is so invigorating and supportive. It's okay, I can't explain it.
Well, this question is my favorite of a whole bunch. As pagans, we celebrate the wheel of the year, which means about every 6 weeks we have a major holiday. The next one coming up, some of you might have heard of, we call it Samhain, you call it Halloween, All Hallows Eve. Samhain is our new year. It's when the year starts again. It's the third harvest, and it's also the time when the veil between worlds is the thinnest. The next thinnest time would be Beltane, which is in the spring. We like to do all sorts of things. You'll see a lot of stuff for Samhain in Spirit Halloween. You'll see a lot of the things that we have done
That's really remarkable. Is there anything additional that you would like us to know about your respective faiths? This might be something you'd like to highlight, or maybe a misconception that you'd like to correct. But what would you like to make sure that the rest of us take away about your respective traditions? And maybe.
Misconceptions or something that you'd like corrected about Lutheranism, I should let you know that there are many branches of Lutheranism in the world and here in the United States. So you have the ELCA, which is the largest, which we're from, Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. If you go to Germany, it's not called Lutheran, it's called the Evangelical Church, because that's the root of the word. One of the things that you need to know as well is that there are other large Lutheran congregations like the Missouri Synod, Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, which is in this community as well. Language that is used in terms of speaking about those bodies is that the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod is conservative, ELCA is more all-inclusive, welcoming, or sometimes the word liberal is thrown at us. Sometimes even progressive might be used. I want you to know that it is important for us to understand that there is also the Wisconsin branch of Lutheranism, which is even more conservative than Missouri branch. And then there's the Free Church, which is the Lutherans as well. And they're all different forms of Lutheranism. But I want to stay within my tradition to clarify something for you that might be in your mind, or you might have questioned about the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America. Now, the Evangelical Lutheran Church in America is, in its broadest sense, very welcoming of all people. Okay? In 2009 in Minneapolis, the church voted to be welcoming to all people. That means LGBTQIA plus people are welcomed into our church. And what the church did, which was consistent with our polity, is that we are a church that is a confederation, we might say, of autonomous congregations. And what the church said in its assembly is that we will be welcoming all people as a church, but each congregation must decide how it wants to practice that hospitality. So a church can say, yes, we would like to have to be so welcoming that we can have an LGBTQIA plus person as a pastor. Another church might say, well, we are not there. We would welcome such people in the congregation, but we might not want somebody in the pulpit. So we're a church that is very diverse in terms of how we practice welcome and hospitality. So people need to know that. And I think when we know that, we will shy away from the labels to speak more about the ethos of the church as a church that welcomes people, but as a church that is still discerning how to practice that welcome. And that's very important for us to understand and keep in mind when we talk about the church. When we talk about welcoming, we have both male and female as pastors. You know, this is over 50 years, you know, we've had that practice. Whereas in the Missouri Synod, there's only male pastors, you know, there's no female pastors. So there's some distinctions. Important for us to know as well is that the Lutheran Church is a liturgical church. By that I mean, when we practice the faith, we practice it with seasonal emphasis. Advent, which is the first 4 weeks leading up to Christmas, then the season of Christmas, which is 12 days, then we enter the period of Epiphany, the manifestation of Christ in the world, beginning with his baptism. And then that leads into Lent, where we begin with Ash Wednesday and then goes for 40 days to Easter, right? And then Easter, you know, then lends itself over to Pentecost, the birthday of the church, you might say. And Pentecost is a long season within the church. And these seasons are for liturgical colors. So Advent is blue, Christmas is white, Epiphany is white and green. And Lent is purple, and Easter is white. And then we go into Pentecost, it's red, like Reformation. We put back red for Reformation. And in the season of Pentecost, let me just say this. When we say Pentecost, it's, you know, it's really life in the Spirit. The emphasis is life in the Spirit. That leads itself to the end of the cycle, which is Christ the King. And this year, Christ the King is at the end of November. And then Advent starts again. So that's the rhythm, we might say, of the Lutheran Church and its practice. Now, that rhythm is not unique to ELC, but it's across all Lutherans, even though we might be different in terms of what we practice or polity, who can be in the pulpit, who can be welcomed, and so on.
Yeah, as a Southern Baptist, we too have we have a large family, and so there is quite a few differences of opinion when you go from church to church. So our church, as I mentioned, is in the state of Missouri. There's 1,800 Missouri Baptist churches, and each one of those churches, same word, autonomous, and can have sort of its own rhythms. They can decide the emphasis that they're going to preach. There's not a specific liturgy or things of that nature that are a part of their tradition. But overall, the idea is we do believe that God has spoken, and we take the scripture seriously, and we try our best to live by those. And we understand in Big Baptist tradition that there's going to be differences of opinion from church to church, and sometimes within the church, from person to person. So we try to be very humble. But in our tradition, we do use the scriptures, the Bible, Old and New Testament, so the Hebrew Bible and the Greek New Testament. We hold those as the revealed word of God. And I would say that as a Southern Baptist, of all denominations, we ought to be the most humble. Our denomination was formed in the 1840s on a principle that is, quite frankly, wrong and evil in every sense. I won't get into that. And the denomination has admitted that and said that they were wrong, that those persons in the mid-19th century had a wrong view of what the Bible said. And so one of the things that bothers me sometimes is that in our denomination, because there are so many Baptist churches, there's some arrogance sometimes. And I think we ought to be the most humble of all people, because we've made some serious mistakes in our history. And we've had to own that. And shame on us if we didn't. But there is a sense in which that makes me proud, where I can say good people sometimes get things wrong. And then there's sometimes just bad people that have their own agendas. But the idea there is allowing something bigger than us, for us, the Word of God, to shape us and conform us to the image of Christ, and not allow our own sociological and philosophical ideals speak into our worship. And so that's one thing about Baptists. I think when that word Baptist, it's a very broad term. There's a lot of different aspects of Baptist life, just as we heard about the Lutheran Church. And some of the shade that gets thrown our way, we deserve it. But at the same time, I think there's also a need for us to be humble and to listen better, and to realize that the important thing is that we are constantly being reformed, that we're constantly allowing God to shape us and conform us to His image.
Hmm. Oh, so many commonalities. I would like to go back and circle back around to the five streams that I couldn't name in my brief moment of excitement. And the United Church of Christ was formed from Evangelical Christian Church, Reform, Afro-American Church, and the Congregational Church. And, you know, one thing I read not too long ago was, the United Church of Christ, they don't know what to believe. And I giggled, but that's not true. One thing I think the United Church of Christ is good at, and I kind of follow behind But if you come to St. John's Chapel United Church of Christ, you're going to have a very welcoming, open, and affirming church to all kinds of people. You might go to another UCC church, and they might not be there yet. And that's really the thing. It's not that some UCC churches are jerks and others aren't. It's that we're all on this journey together, and we're all in different places, and we're all learning, and we're all growing. And one of the best things we could probably do is do that together and allow that grace and create those spaces where it's okay. It's okay. And I think the same thing connects with Christianity in general. There's a lot of harsh things that are said about Christians. There's harsh things I've said about Christians. And I think one of the best reminders I've ever had is that church and Christians, we're people. No matter what our denomination is, no matter what our faith tradition is, we are people. And we're all just trying to do, we're trying to find our way, and we're on this journey together. And sometimes I think we need to go back to that.
I'm going to tie two things into one. I can do this. Judaism is not just a religion, it is an ethno-religion. So there is a lot of cultural component because it's a religion that dates back over 2,000 years.
Time's up.
Okay.
Sorry.
It's okay. It's done now. she's harsh. So it being an ethno-religion means that the definition, it's really hard to explain. I mean, ethno-religion, Steve, would you like to go there? Yeah, see, it's complicated. And Judaism is not a monolith. Like Christianity, there are flavors, we don't like the term denomination because that's very Christian, movement. Yeah, we like to separate ourselves from Christians. We have good reason for that. Just saying, there's a history there. Not between me and Steph, but you know, the rest of it. So we like movements, and the movements really started in the mid-1700s as a response to an emancipation and reformation and all that cool stuff. We can have that history lesson later. This I'm good at. But the movements are not so boxed, so well-defined. So people, a lot of Jews, slide in and out of them. And just because they belong to a particular community doesn't mean they always define themselves by that community. And so when you ask someone, you can get the most peculiar responses, right? So our congregation here in the Springfield area, because it's not in Springfield, is aligned with the Reform movement, but we have members that range from Orthodox to atheists, to cultural Jews. And so people will say, well, I'm more Reformadox, or I'm more Conservadox, meaning I'm kind of on the border between Conservative and Orthodox Jewry, or I like this out of there and that out of the other thing. And that is not uncommon among Jews, because Judaism has developed to meet the needs of its people, because yet Jews don't practice what's in the Hebrew Bible. That's a shocker to say.
I'll
do more if you don't want to.
No, I'll. 25 years ago, I was working in Branson, and we were setting up for the holidays, decorating and all that. And I was up on a ladder with another guy, packing up some holly. And it came about that I mentioned that I was a witch. And he looked at me and said, oh, no, you can't be a witch. You're a man, you have to be a warlock. I looked at him and I said, where did you get that idea? And straight face, he looked bewitched. Yeah. Could not beat it into his head with a hammer. What I'd like to tell all of you right now, the movie witches, Wicked on Broadway, TV witches, that's not us. We're people just like you. And we're trying to come out among all of you the women did their passage ritual, and afterwards I walked over to the boys and I said, well, what did you think of it? This is what we do. And the one boy looked up at me and said, I thought you were going to sacrifice an animal. I said, no, that's a Santeria, that's a whole other group. But we have groups under the pagan umbrella all the way from Anton LaVey and the Church of Satan down to the little simple head witch, kitchen witches that are out there that make their magic with food and herbs. But we're just people. And we're running out of time, so I think I'll stop there.
Well, I appreciate all of your insight. I wish we had a lot more time for each of you. In fact, open invitation, my treat, dinner, lunch, breakfast, taking you out, continue the conversation, I would love to hear it. Darlene is going to help with questions from the audience. We want to know, what do you want to hear more of? Do you want to have a different understanding of something particularly, a question for somebody particular or in general, whatever it is, just let her know. Looks like I've got a hand over there. Particular person that wants to jump in can jump in, but really the synopsis of the question is, what is your experience with youth connected to your faith, young adults youth? Are they staying? Are they leaving? Are they resonating? If so, why? And an understanding of that.
I'll start. So generally, and then we'll talk specifically, generally it is not uncommon, and I don't want to speak for everyone else, but that young people go off and explore, they do the college thing, and don't really get re-involved in synagogue life until they have children. When it becomes important, like how are we gonna raise the next generation? That doesn't mean they don't participate or do things, right? And there's always a group that's always involved, and there's a group that's always kind of involved, and a group that's not involved. But I'm gonna go there. I didn't want to talk about this, but I'm gonna go there and say, in the last year, because of the rise in anti-Semitism, because people have not been able to separate Israel from Jews, a lot of college students who may not have been, Jewish college students who may not have been otherwise involved, are. And it's not for spiritualness, it's for safety. If they're going to be outed, as if one has to be outed for this, of all the things one should be outed for, as if one should be outed for anything, right? If people are going to point at them, and that's the least of the things that have happened, they want that sense of community. Now, I will say, the Jewish student population at MSU is extraordinarily minuscule, because Jewish students don't come here, because it's not really a Jewish place to be. But I know this from other communities.
Okay, I'll follow that. Our group is growing by leaps and bounds. We're getting your young people. They are coming, they are experimenting, and some will stick with us. But I'm gonna give you a bit of hope. A lot of them are here just because, oh, hey, it looked cool in the movies. We had a lot of that. And those folks will find out what we do, they'll find out we can't clean the house by wiggling their nose. Yeah, I know. But, and they will go back. Again, to her point, they're experimenting. It's like Amish runs through. They're experimenting. They're getting to find out what's out there, what actually resonates with them. And if, as you said down there, you get them young and you raise them right, they're going to come back, most of them.
Well, since Austin's, you know, on my staff, I don't know if I should even answer, but I will say this. My daughter just graduated from Northwestern University in Chicago, in Evanston. They have a big Jewish population there, sister.
Yes.
And all of my daughter's best friends were Jewish from the East Coast, like in the Boston, New York area.
Mm-hmm.
And she built such great relationships with them. And so I would show up for, we would take all of her friends for pizza, okay? And to answer the question about like where the youth are, I found they were drinking in spiritual conversation. It was so funny. One of the guys, brilliant kid, just brilliant. He's working in Manhattan right now. He's taking a job in Manhattan. And he says to me, he says, "You're the first evangelical I've ever talked to." And so he just had all these crazy off-the-wall questions, like way out there kind of stuff, because he just didn't know. So I found that if
just so you know, I get those questions here.
I bet. And it's invigorating because there wasn't really any agenda other than just curiosity and learning. So I think that honestly, regardless, I think our young people want to have those conversations. We ought to be bold and brave to have those conversations. It's a shame that this room isn't full of people having that conversation, because most people are looking for some sort of spiritual expression. They know there's something there more than just the empirical, rational, logical, and oh, such a wonderful, I wish that would be more rational and logical sometimes, to be honest with you. But there's also the spiritual. And so I'm finding that those conversations are out there if we're brave enough to have them.
I want to jump in and say a couple of things, because I think we need to all this all the question that is asked. In its true perspective. I endorse what was said before, but I want to say that we are living in a difficult era. And I want to describe that era this way, that what was very common 20 or 30 years back is no longer so. Technology has changed the way we look at things and how we act and how we behave. Like simply, my phone is more than just a phone. It's a computer. It can do so many different things. Now, this is what the young people have. When you see that, they spend a lot of time here. Now, I want to say this. When we talk about where the young people are, we know where they are. It's not that we're unaware of where they are. The young people are into service. They're into issues of justice. Okay? That's where you see them advocating for justice and reacting to what we sometimes take for granted and don't really take seriously in their opinion, is the very narrow-mindedness or tunnel vision that sometimes characterizes the church. Now, ritual practice is what you, the question might be getting at, that the young people are not into the ritual practice as they used to be before. But let's face it, the religion of today is sports. What dominates on the weekends is sports, right? We have it on all the television stations. Universities, their biggest thing these days is sports. Their coaches get more money than the people who administer the schools. I mean, look at it carefully. I used to be in Kansas City, and I used to watch Bill Self, who is at KU as the basketball coach, getting 5 point something million, and the provost is not getting nearly anything near that, right? And the basketball is the thing. Soccer is the thing. Football is the thing. That's where you find the young people, right? When Arkansas went to every city against Tennessee, I think it was, right? The old stadium was invaded by whom? Young people. They were there with all the energy and so on, right? So we have to bear that in mind. That's one. Secondly, because of technology, the young people don't have to get up in the morning at 9:30 to go to worship anymore. Okay? You know why? Because we've made it easy for them. Live streaming. Okay? Stay at home and they live stream it. And if they don't care to watch what the live stream is presenting, they just shut down. At least they've shown up and they've exited, right? Now, so we have that. We have live streaming, we have sports, right? Important, we have the role of parents. We have to ask the question, where are the parents? Young people are not adults to do their own thing. They become adults at a certain age, but if we don't shape them by the way we did, then we will not have them in those places, right? I'm a pastor, but my sons have grown up in the church, and we didn't make it a law. We made it something that we experienced from the time they were born. So from the time they were baptized, they were in church with us. From the time they were birthed, they were in church with us, and they were always in church with us during Sunday school. We dropped it, we talk about the faith, we talk about important things in society, we relate to the faith, to the common experiences of life, current faith. So we want to keep those things in mind. And we want to say, I want to echo what I think it was Dr. Myers said, that, you know, they come back after they're married and they have kids. But even marriage is being redefined today, you know. So there's a multitude of things that we can point to that we can say is influencing how the young people react to faith and how the young people want to define their faith. They don't want us to define it by saying Lutheran or Roman Catholic or Presbyterian or Baptist or what have you. They want to have that freedom to say how they define it. And listen, in the religious market, there's a lot out there. There's Buddhism, there's, you know, all kinds of things out there that, you know, they get into. In fact, I'm reading a book in which the Episcopalian bishop says, I practice Native American Indian religion, and I practice Zen Buddhism, and I'm learning from all these things, and I offer them to you. So we have to hold things in perspective. We're living in a different time, right? And it's not that we don't have to jump on the young people to say, hey, you're not coming to church. Why are you not coming to church? I think it's better for us to find ways to meet them where they are, because what was the norm is no longer today.
Amen. Thank you. I want to go ahead and get some more questions while we still have time.
Cool. Deanna, yeah. Could I actually answer that question?
Absolutely.
Okay.
There's
one piece that I want to throw in there that I think we need to consider in why young people aren't coming to our churches like they used to. We haven't done a very good job as Christians. And I'm coming from a perspective of transgender youth, people who are questioning their sexuality and their identity, from gay folks, lesbians, the whole spectrum. We haven't done very well. We've closed our doors for many of years. I have horror stories of people who have had terrible things happen to them. And they wouldn't step foot into a Christian church again. I I'm grateful that we have a church where I'm in my third year there, and we had, I believe, two youth when we started. But when we become more inclusive, and when we hold space for different people and people who don't share the same experiences than us, and we just let them go through their journey, they are going to find God, and they're going to find God in their own way. However, maybe it's not even the name of God, and I think we as Christians can do better in holding that space for them.
Thank you, Cindy. Great addition. Thank you. Okay, there's another question.
Yeah, I just want to add, it's about 8:20, so we only have about 10 minutes. That would be some conversation afterwards.
Is there a pressing question you want the whole panel? Otherwise, we'll break and we'll go to a munch and mingle, and you're welcome to ask those questions individually. Anything really pressing? Okay, I think that, oh, jump in. And then we will just have one person answer, or three speaker.
I would like to speak on behalf of my experience as a film videographer and live streamer to about 20 or 30 different nonprofits that I've served here in the community over the past decade. And I'm currently on the MSU campus quite regularly doing filming and behind the scenes work here. And my passion through has always been ministry since I was a child. And things like when I'm at home alone in the quiet, one of the things that keeps coming back to me is, what are the changes that we can adopt and open our hearts to that would make this inclusivity such a desirable thing that they want to come? I see certain events across the country where people show up by the tens of thousands with jubilant celebration of their faith in different ways. And I come to other places where I see dynamic opportunities that have such a few that are in attendance, and it doesn't seem like it becomes attractive. So my question is, how can we find a platform, whether it's musical, dance, poetry, tradition, a combination of things that would cause students to want to come, not just by a dozen or two, but by maybe 1,000 or 10,000. I see some of the gatherings, and I watch them. In many cases, they do things that my parents would never, ever want to do. They were open to change and doing maybe more exotic physical expressions in church, whether it be dance or different kinds of things. So what would you suggest would be a way to build a new platform for attraction?
So what I'm getting out of Jolene's questions from her is really, is there a platform to bring youth in? And this might take a lot of discussion. So if somebody just has a quick idea that they want to share, otherwise share it with Jolene afterwards.
I think that the question needs to be directed to the youth. I mean, look at us up here. Nothing youthful up here, actually. I mean, I think we have to ask the young people themselves that question. They would be the best to articulate it. If I were to try to articulate it for them, I would be doing them an injustice. So I think we have to get them and ask them the question, put the question to them. Of course, we must be willing to hear honestly what they will share. I think that's what we should be ready for. And we must be willing to find theological ways in which to validate their offerings and not to dismiss their offerings. So that's how I would answer the question.
Thank you. I appreciate it, Pastor Arnkins. There is a ministerial kind of group here on campus at MSU. I know Reverend Michelle Scott-Huffman, who's sitting next to you, is connected to that. And with the new MSU president, Dr. Williams, I know he's been introduced to it. So I would say go that avenue and ask the students, and then see how the faith community can come along with students' suggestions to build that. We are going to go ahead and close. I want to point out a couple of thank yous. First of all, Darlene, there she is, right in the middle, who's with our community partnerships in the Ozarks. We're so grateful for them. And it was her vision to bring these discussions with faith people's lives. So we're so grateful for that. We also want to thank David Burton from the Missouri Extension Office, who has a Neighboring 101 program. I know I'm speaking to the choir, but if you have not signed up and pledged to be a good neighbor through the Neighboring 101 program, see this man and then watch the videos and the things that he's done and the newsletters. You can become a better steward with your neighbors and also within whatever faith you have, that resonates together, and we appreciate that. The other discussions, if you haven't seen them, are recorded on his platform, so you can watch other faith groups. We will see you back in November, November 14th, where we'll have five more faiths, and that will conclude with 25 different faith leaders in our community having discussions and sharing, which I'm excited about. If you are interested in more of them, there is an idea of potentially doing one-on-one interviews like podcasts going forward, where we do weekly interviews and they're a little bit longer to show the diversity in the Ozarks and show kind of that more full picture of each faith that we just got a taste of today. So if you'll join me in a round of applause, thank our panelists. And there will be munchies up there. Please head that way and panelists will come up. You can ask any questions you want. Thank you.
All right. Thank you for joining us for that session number four, and look forward to seeing you at our fifth session live, I hope. But thank you for watching.